Ladies and gentlemen, friends and fellow travelers, good morning. It's a great, great pleasure to welcome you to the panel today about art and poetry, about the artist as a poet. It's an ongoing conference, actually an ongoing symposium, which came out of a dialogue with Mark Spiegler and Annette Schönholzer, whom I would like to thank very, very much. We thought after the panel, which was developed earlier on about the future of the museum, which was a panel which went on for many, many years, which I had moderated about the museum in many different geographies, about a year and a half ago, that it would be interesting to focus on artists and have panels about different forms of practice. It started last year here in Miami with a panel about the artist as the inventor of art schools, many different art schools run by artists. We then continued it in Basel in June with a panel about the artist as an urbanist and architect, but mainly urbanist. And we now today continue it with the artist as a poet. I'd like to welcome very much and thank very much our panelists. A very, very warm welcome to Gerry, Bibby, to Dr. Tracey, Emin, to Olivier, Garbay, to Karl, Holmqvist, and to Jonas, Mekas. A very warm welcome. And obviously it's a big topic with poetry, so I spoke a couple of weeks ago to the wonderful Brazilian poet, Augusto de Campos, one of the pioneers of concrete poetry since the 50s. And he told me that perhaps we could define poetry by contrasting it with prose, except in cases like Joyce, poetry is always what cannot be sold or what does not sell. It doesn't narrate anything. It has no usefulness, or it is merely useful in its uselessness through the ethical and aesthetic awareness that results from it. Poetry, and experimental poetry in particular, which sustains this awareness most radically, is what remains of a genre that has almost disappeared from the human race. It holds out in a world where people are tending to lose all their spiritual values in favor of practical predatory goals. So De Campo said it's very, very urgent for this reason to return to poetry. It's also interesting if you look at the 20th century avant-garde movements, if it's surrealism or if it's Dada or name any movement, there have always been these very strong ties between art and poetry. When we went to see Czeslaw Milosz, the late Nobel Prize winning poet, he was almost 100 years old, he told us that for him, poetry very often is structurally much more akin actually to a collage. He particularly saw this method in visual assemblage, for example, of T.S. Eliot. He translated The Wasteland into Polish and always thought that the sort of whole connection of T.S. Eliot to art was very strong. But he also emphasized the painter of modern life by 19th century French poet Charles Baudelaire, of course, because their shared interest in visual arts. Today, we have five artists who are going to talk about their practice in connection to poetry, and we thought to structure the panel as follows, that we're going to have readings at first, that all the participants will actually make a poetry reading, and we'll then, in a second part of the panel, have a discussion. I'll ask some questions, maybe there are questions among the participants, and then, in the last part, we'll open it to the floor. So I'm very happy to now hand over the mic to Karl Holmqvist. Karl.
The time is now 10 past 10. The time is now 10 past 10. 5 to midnight. The time is now. Ten past ten, 5 to midnight. I'm not there. For the times, they are changing. Class-free society, no leader. For the times, they are changing. Reconsider. Women leaders, race car drivers will be women, Mona Lisa's mustache wearing the pants, sick in bed, in the hospital bed, taking care. Please take good care. Nothing to wear in the harem, at the prom, the masked ball, murder, schoolyard, massacre. Run this mother. Run this mother. Run this mother. Girls who run the world. Girls who run the world. Girls, women and girls rule my world. I say they rule my world. Who run this mother? Who run this mother? A house is not a home. Powerless structures, a house is not a home. Susan Sontag, Heidi Montag. Susan Sontag, Heidi Montag. Susan Sontag, Heidi Montag. A house is not a home. Notes on camp. The time is now 10 past 10. Kim Wilde, Oscar Wilde. Kim Wilde, Oscar Wilde. Kim Wilde, Oscar Wilde. Run this mother. Run this mother. Run this mother. T.S. Eliot, Missy Elliot. T.S. Eliot, Missy Elliot. T.S. Eliot, Missy Elliot. The die is cast. Stop the hate. Stop the hate. Stop the hate. Stop. Stop the hate. Stop the fear. Stop racism. Stop the race. Second class, first place, second rate. I don't wanna. I don't think so. I don't wanna. I don't think so. I don't wanna. I don't think so. Baby, the villain or Venus is more beautiful than a race car. Re-love ocean. Earth belongs to all. It's alone. The mother planet and capitalism. The movement. The movement. The movement. Endless column. The movement to end capitalism. End capitalism now. Hate of women in the harem, alienation in the workplace. In the harem, alienation in the workplace. Hate of women and capitalism. And capitalism now. Hate of women, straight white male, the beached whale. Dynamite in China. Same kind of people who think wearing a suit and tie is just dressing normal. World domination, the United Nation, gun control. Abuse of power comes as no surprise. Abuse of power comes as no surprise. You know, for the times, they are a-changing.
Thank you so very, very much, Karl. Many of you will have seen Karl's work in this year's Venice Biennale in Bice Kuriger's exhibition. Most recently, Karl has published a magazine within the magazine, which is an insert for Parquet magazine. I think that's the most recent project. There has been a wonderful dialogue, actually, and that leads us to our next speaker between Karl and Gerry Bibby in the context of Based in Berlin, when we did a conversation there. Gerry did a poetry garden, one can say, near the Hamburger Bahnhof, and will now do his reading. A very warm welcome to Gerry Bibby.
Thanks. Just a small disclaimer, this action score has been soiled. No picnic border control. Setting. The primary location here is a demarcated area enlisted, whether habitually or with a rarefied concentration, by numerous bodies in the pursuit of exchange or entertainment of some kind. The convergence of the bodies on this area is predominantly prompted by an expectation that presumes the bodies approach from somewhere and then stop. The exchange that ensues may be performed passively or actively. However, the area is usually noted for its ability to host something of interest for the bodies. Action. The aim of this action is to construct a presentation using the formal limitations of the primary location and its functions, yet grafting onto its architecture the possibility of qualifying inherent contingencies. Realizing that each body converging on this primary site is a receptacle for the significances of secondary locations, two, possibly more, and this is where the score has been soiled. Players will prepare appendages that will accompany them during the designated times prior to the performance of the thing of interest. They should be roughly proportional representation of the performers' bodies. Through this, the players will negotiate the problem of qualifying the seemingly arbitrary performed activities that signify context by translating observation into documented spoken texts. These will parallel other texts that assume to impart a possibly more abstract relationship to the specific frame the setting imposes. Dear Gerry, I'm sorry we didn't get to meet when you were last in New York. I understand you might be going to Art Basel Miami this year. If you're planning to come to New York afterwards, I would love to talk to you in person about the program we're organizing. If you're coming to New York afterwards, we have two events in our identity series, which I'm sure you'd be interested in. Please note, however, that this information is embargoed until 22nd of November 2011, so you will need to keep this information for yourself now. Thing, Thought, Fluxus Editions, 1962 to 1978, September 21, 2011 to January 16, 2012. View-related events. Participating in scientific, educational, professional, religious, or business conventions is a permissible B1, B2 activity, and I assume you will not receive any kind of honorarium. If you do so, then there are a few restrictions. Daddy Tattoo, 2005. January 14, 2011, April 22nd, 2011. Dear Gerry, many thanks for your note. I'd be happy to contribute. I'm eager to discuss with you. I will be in Miami this week, and I look forward to meeting you there. My best. Reservation number 2WCVAP. 1.1bibby/gerard.anthony.ms/ADT. 1LH2733H02DECFRTXLDUSHK1 10:20A/11:25A/O$J01E 2LH466H02DECFRDUSMIAHK1 12:15P45/445P/X$J01SKE. This year we would like to invite you to take part in a conversation entitled Important. This message may be contain confidential or legally privileged information. If you think it was sent to you by mistake, please delete all copies and advise the sender. For the purpose of the Spam Act 2003, this mail is authorized by AGS. The way to the airport unveiled vast tracts of unruly flatlands, blanketed this time of year by wildflowers and a cacophony of weeds. The sea was being parted, carved, into designated this side and that by battalions of bulldozers, paving ways for carpets of tar. Meanwhile, in the center of town, roadworks, etc., gave way to window dressing. They moved through the days with the promise of prosperous deluge and sun. Healthy rains were few and far between, and in the gasping dry, discontent was fostered. The landscape witnessed the expectant mutate into doubtful dowagers of ill-gotten estates. Their bloodlines, however, were merely tied to crowns by way of bloodied waltzes through New World gardens, where incestuous ventriloquists plucked, posied, and sometimes rerooted their ancestral blooms. Their inheritance, the legacies of a grandly modern potted public. All the while, the promise flickered and flashed from their peripheries right through the centers of their often cross-eyed POVs. In this saturated drought, populated by strangled hopefuls wrestling for gadgets to anchor their discontents, reinforcements were hired to fell and, prune unruly thorns, seeded by a noxious speculation to whom the constabulary had been grafted. The sky was argyled by the fluffy streams of jumbo jets, their near intersecting hulks resembling air games like those in Top Gun, dogfights, where the passengers are as pumped as Iceman and Tom. 25 years later, only business travelers and tourists could behave so gratuitously in times of war. He dressed himself up in the manner of one who presents themselves. To which manner was the pressing point? The straight and narrow, or boulevard as some may have it. Such slender limbs, presuming adornment of a kind that gives rise to a bloom demanding reverence, its fierce perseverance eclipsing orderly conduct, robust varietals filled space. Won't you grant me, will I not take, when the sun fades and workers and students and shoppers have retreated behind walls and into corridors, the opportunity to roll beneath the thrust of your fountains, devote my gurgling face to your lourd artifice, subject my chest and knee to the soda pop fountain, my lemonade legs rolling with downy cheeks, as proud as their classical butts, projecting counterpostures? Or was that the privilege of those incestuous ventriloquists for whom these boundaries cradled a cornucopia of fruits, one from the backs of others, yet allowing my projected dream of luridness and abandon? Thank you. Thank you.
Is it okay if I stand up?
Sorry?
Is it okay if I stand up?
Yeah, that's great. So a very, very warm welcome to Tracey Emin, who obviously has most recently shown her work in a retrospective at the Hever Gallery, but has also always had this parallel reality as a poet, has a poetry column, and is going to read now, I think, some new and some old poems. Very warm welcome to Tracey.
Han said, will you come and speak on the poetry panel? And I said yes, thinking we were going to speak about poetry. So I didn't bring any of my poetry with me. And Han said, don't worry, we can get it online. And I said, don't worry, I'll write some new poetry. And he said, this will be great, poetry about Miami. Now, I've been having a really good time here. And the only Miami poem that I've written, which is very much out of character, is Miami, Bonami, I am happy. And when I'm happy, I don't even think like that. And I was just rhyming words with Miami. And when I'm happy, I can't write. It's impossible. When I write, it's when I'm sad, because writing is my friend, my companion, and where my thoughts go. So this morning, I broke a lot of this up into poetry, but as we are not actually, we're discussing poetic thoughts as much as anything. I'm just going to read a first extract from my new book, Vanishing Lake, and then I'm just going to read a longer piece. But before I do that, I'm going to recite a poem that I wrote in 1992, 93, if I can remember it. It's very short. You put your hand across my mouth, but still the noise continues. Every part of me is screaming, about to be smashed into 1,000,000,000 pieces, each part forever belonging to you. So that's one of my favorite poems that I wrote. First extract. She looked into the mirror. I made a fool of myself again, a fool like a stupid child, a child that has never known love, a soul that has never been touched. She began to cry, knowing that everything is as it should be. She was a fool, and it was too late. The lake had gone. So now I'm going to read this longer piece. I have to stand up, because otherwise I find it difficult to project my voice with any kind of emotion. So a lot of the things I write, unless it's for a newspaper or something, is usually about love. But at the moment, I'm writing about the fact that I don't know if I believe in love anymore. So within my writing, I'm looking for love, and that's the dialogue. Okay. She lay there thinking, just 5 more minutes. Not 5 more minutes with someone else. Not 5 more minutes of sleep, but 5 more minutes of trying to remember what it was like to be held, warm, close, safe body, holding her soft, warm, close, breathing heart, close. Her head sunk into the pillow. She thought, just 5 more minutes of this memory. She pulled herself up out of the bed, and looking out the window, she could see the red rays of the sunrise casting their long arms across the olive trees. She had a vision of her father in Cyprus standing on a ladder, his head and arms wrestling with the branches of a tree as he picked his way at the olives and in handfuls throwing them into the bucket that stood close by. He knew everything about olive trees, how to prune, how to cut, and when to take. She loved the olive trees. She felt they were her protectors, like centurions guarding her from the fear of nature. She was afraid of the land. Sometimes it was a mirror, and other times a giant, vast entity, alive and moving, waiting to eat her up, to consume her, to take her away. She looked into the mirror and said, "Why would I want to be with anyone who does not want to be with me?" All her life, she'd been chasing the impossible moment of love, to grasp something almost impenetrable, the heart of a ghost. She sat on the edge of the bed, and rubbing her feet across the coarse matting like a sulky child, she repeated the words, "Dead people, more dead people, always dead people, why do I only see the dead?" Okay. I should say, yeah, this bit's finished, so, okay. As she screamed, she hit herself again and again and again, punching her face into a pulp. The more he tried to pull her arms away, the more insane she became. "You don't touch me, you don't love me, you don't touch me." Half of the hate for herself came from the lack of love of others. The other half came from what she thought was the truth. Could a person be born hurt, be damaged? Could she have been born with a broken heart? She knelt down to pick up the buttercup. She knelt down to pick up the buttercup. She held the little thing under her chin and turned to imagine its sunlight reflection. She had collected 17 different flowers on her walk, poppies, daisies, but most she didn't know their names. She wondered if it mattered, whether it would mean more to her if she did. White cabbage butterflies flew low over the long green grass like oversized confetti. Everything so delicate, everything so light. She was very careful to see where she trod. She was very careful about everything. Everything apart from when she was drunk. Then things would go out of control, like the carefulness had turned into a giant volcano, burst in ash clouds of emotion, burning everything in her wake. She did not want to live like the walking dead. She wanted to feel alive. She wanted to show passion. She sat down at the mini Stonehenge, and looking out across the land, the points, and then down to the sea, over the giant waves of blue, she swore to God never to have apologetic sex again. She tried to remember the last time she had made love, when she had felt love, when she had felt lost and her soul had fused with another's, but she couldn't. All she got was a visual action of two people fucking, one of them being her, a muffled soundproof of emotion of nothingness, just an empty sad vision hanging on the horizon of the sky. She knew that the secret was nature, but now nature had cast her aside. Making love was an act forever, she thought, but forever had cast her aside too. There was no magic. She saw too much reality. She felt and saw her own rejection. She looked down at the wild posy of flowers held tightly in her hand, the green sap of the stems now staining her palms, and she promised herself, one day I'll learn to know their names. Yeah, that's it.
Tracey, thank you so very much. And actually, it was at the Serpentine Poetry Marathon that both you and also Olivier read poems. And I have now got the great pleasure to introduce Olivier, who is working on a new book now, Mes Enfants d'Hier.
I mean, this one is done already. I'm working on Tintin and the Serpent, which is in English, and it's about the Serpentine thing.
So a very warm welcome to Olivier.
Thank you. Anyway, hi, everyone. Well, I choose to read four different texts. Two of them are not from me. They are translations I've just made. And so the first poem is from Jacques Prévert from 1946. Of the family. The mother knits, the son is at war. She finds that rather natural, the mother. And the father, what does he do, the father? He is a businessman. His wife knits, his son is at war. He does business. He finds that rather natural, the father. And the son, what does he think, the son? He thinks absolutely nothing, the son. The son, his mother knits, his father does business and he is at war. When he is finished with the war, he will do business with his father. The war goes on, the mother goes on, she knits. The father goes on, he does business. The son is killed. He does not go on. The father and the mother go to the cemetery. They find that rather natural, the father and the mother. Life goes on with the knitting, the war and the business, the war, the knitting, the war, the business, the business, the business, life with the cemetery. The second text I'm going to read is a translation from Marguerite Duras. It's written in the 80s. It's called La Vie Matérielle. And this is an extract which is about the lucky speech. My mother was afraid of people having public functions, of civil servants, of treasurers, of ushers, of custom officers, of all these whose function was to enforce the law. Always guilty with this mentality of the poor. She never completely escaped it. I escaped it from my mother's fear with the oral exams. After every exam passed, I had a feeling of progress against the endemic poverty of the family. The lucky speech. It was like a confrontation in between my body and the social body, which was there to lose me. Singers, actors, must lead the same party with the public. People that pay to hear you sing or talk are enemies that you will have in order to leave. Once it happened to you, to dominate the speech, to take the whole crowd with you, then it happens to you all the time. We pretend to make it our duty not to disappoint these people who have traveled to hear you. But it is a little more than that. It overflows a little on murder, the murder of this one who came to judge you. The third text is an extract from a book published in 2007 called Don Quixote and Sancho Panza Make Newcastle. This one is called Here. Just tell me where you've put it. I gave it to you. Have you now? I gave it to you, I swear. No need to bring blood into this. Are you going to bleed me? Only if you've lost it. Where is it then? The regular sound of a bird, all feathered up, ready to go to the opera, had unexpectedly decided, reconciled with pride, to awake Eros himself. There were no limits to their mythology. Their multicolored souls had no time for cheap politics. A century had already passed over us, only to repeat yet again the same experience afresh, offering renewed the opportunity to break free from the seemingly overpowering mold. Pushing hard and strong, all complex against a fence to size the extent of their bows, now gone away to practice self-defense. Here, a sound so deep is heard that it shatters even bones into more dust, yet reinventing the meaning of fear. There, hope, the echoing murmur of a legendary lyre, ripples along fascination, keeping going dear. Or rather now, profoundly enslaving themselves to deep, raunchy bass beats, and many more wet dreams by pointy teeth prettily singing in the early heat. Oh yes, thank you. I found it. I had it in me. And to finish, I just recite this poem I finished the marathon at the Serpentine with. My hound. From Arcadia to Belinda, do not remember me at all. Remember it in the shape of the teardrop of rain, my bait, swiftly swept from top to toe at the corner of your rose, so slimy, so shiny, it can only be the trail of a snail, toying respectfully with the rest in pieces, the flakes and nibbles of the action. A frog leapt, a bird flew, calling an invisible worm to the rescue. Thank you.
Olivier, thank you so very, very much. And I'm now super happy to introduce Jonas Mekas, who in his many, many parallel activities, of course, his pioneering work with film, his pioneering work as a curator, his pioneering work as a writer, has also his pioneering work as a poet. And I came across his poems the first time actually in the Daybook, which is an older poetry collection, and Jonas is now working on a new book of his poems called Letters. A very warm welcome to Jonas Mekas.
This is from my upcoming book, The Letters. This one is from 2003 to Agnes Beck. Dear Agnes, the young people were young, their happiness was totally and openly happy, and their beauty was beautiful and exhilaratingly innocent and contagious as only innocence can be. I looked, I listened, I saw, and it was so freeing and so totally somewhere else and so far from what's on TV and newspapers, the world of the nature and the grown-ups. And as I contemplated it, all like this, pushing casually through the crowd, I saw you, Agnes, unmistakably you, who else could be so relaxed, so totally, and so totally there, so totally yourself, and so totally in it all at the same time, an image of transparency and relaxation and happiness. Ah, you managed to become so totally part of no matter what it is, completely and totally with what is now, this moment, embracing it, moving with it, with no effort, lightly and amazingly, lightly and amazingly, like I have seen some same in some old Chinese drawings, same radiance and lightness and happiness, the poetry of life in the faces, postures, and lines of poets and drunks and geishas and haiku geniuses who all had transcended, like you, the pain and absurdity of real life. I thought so as I was walking home through a mild drizzle along the late January Broome Street, thinking and happy. Now I'm typing this, and I have a glass of Cahor still full, Arab drums on radio, and a Persian flute. It has a magic in it, says the musician, and then he plays, and then he plays, and it's all very amazing, dear Agnes. It's all very amazing. Everything, I mean, everything.
Thank you so much. Thank you all for a wonderful reading. And maybe to begin with the discussion, I wanted to ask you a first question to you all. Panofsky says we always invent the future made of fragments from the past. And I was wondering who are kind of heroes or influences in poetry from the past who inspire you when you write. Maybe Karl, do you want to start?
There's a lot of people. Milos would be one. You were mentioning Milos earlier and his meditations on where language can take you. And at the same time, I'm sort of sampling people, and I've been using different people, Brian Geisen, and in what I read, there was Beyonce and. Futurist manifesto, different things, and they're not always things I admire. They're more kind of things that somehow are stuck in my mind and that I try to recombine and energize through the act of quoting and working with them.
And Gerry, what about you?
I don't know, it's kind of a strange situation to think about heroes in the past. I mean, I guess there's lots of people that have existed that I have this kind of more a relationship of solidarity rather than of hero worship, I guess. And I mean, I guess we've talked about this before, but I mean, I guess Jean Genet was my first hero, I guess. But there's some also heroes just in the present, in the room, I guess, as well. Being Karl here, who's a poet. I have a young friend who's younger than all of us here, who, if we're talking about the future, she's in the audience, and she's also a young poet from New York City.
And Tracey?
My main hero would be Mevlana Rumi, the 13th century Sufi mystic poet. And that could be my only real hero, I'd say. And obviously, anyone knows that work or that kind of writing, you can see that I'm still heavily influenced by it, totally. But my favorite poem of all time was written by a 13th century female Arabic poet. And she wrote, I poured out my worries to a friend, hoping it would make me feel better. But all that happened became an open secret, fireflies in the dark. And I'd quite like to have this as an epitaph, because I think it sums up much the way I express myself in life and how we can do things so terribly wrong as well and be misunderstood. And I think also Spinoza, the philosopher, I've always read his work like poetry, like true poetry. So, I don't think poetry, I don't think you have to necessarily read poems to see poetry in life. So.
No. And Olivier?
Well, it just made me think of Hermann Hesse in that way. Very classically, and maybe cliche-like, but Howl and Kaddish of Ginsberg, I'm afraid, had to be talked about. For certainly liberating me, being French, of course, I had all the traditional knowledge of French and quite impressed by it and found it difficult to dare actually write anything. And then by reading the Americans, I freed that. I managed to get free from the old establishment somehow. And so defensively, the Beat generation gave me a boost, of course. But I mean, there would be people like Susan Hiller, there would be people more contemporary of that type. Obviously.
And Jonas, your hero?
I'm influenced by everything that I read. On different days, I go to my shelf of hundreds of poetry books and I pull out one, and it could be from a completely different century, different country, and I like it. On another day, I pick up another, and I like it. And they all influence me. I cannot resist. I'm weak. But if I would really have to name one most influential, that's to do. It would be, you say, I grew up on a farm. I'm a farmer boy. And there was a neighbor, another farmer. And when he used to get drunk, he used to improvise and sing and improvise, and I thought he was the greatest. Someday I will be like him.
That makes great sense.
Yeah.
Great, thank you all so much. When we spoke before in the green room, kind of preparing a bit the panel, we talked about the question of economy, and Tracey, you said it's something I think you also wanted to talk about, because a bit what De Campos told me, you know, this idea that he almost defines poetry as what cannot be sold or what does not sell.
Yeah, but poets don't get paid. That's what I said. Mm. And poetry, I think, exists within the ether. It's like this, kind of almost like music, like this a different way of thinking on a different level, almost like a different parallel way of world or something. And that you can't actually hold or grasp. And it was so beautiful to hear Karl reading out, because if I just read that, I mean, I have to know Karl's voice and think, how would he be reading this? But I would still never in a million years be able to read it myself how I heard Karl read it. And that is timeless. That is, you know, we're lucky to be here and hear that. You know, and so in some ways it's like, it lives within the ether, so.
Karl, do you maybe want
to? Thank you, darling. it can't be sold, no, it could. I mean, there's ways of selling everything, but I think it's also, it's also never finished. This was something else we were saying, and there's something that you kind of pick up and you're always kind of working on. And I think this is I always enjoyed poetry readings very much because the people are there to deliver their thoughts and it's brought back to the person more than in an art fair. You have all these objects that are sort of products from artistic processes, but it's actually people who are actually making these things. And to me, this is the most important. And this kind of process is what you need to give money for so that people can keep up this and position themselves in relation to what they're doing and to what is going on around them in reality.
Mm. Does anybody else want to talk about
that? Yeah, I mean, for me, I guess, I mean, if you're thinking about economy and poetry in some kind of ways, in the context of the art fair, as you say, or whatever, and not being sold. I mean, even if you do sell a book, or if you happen to be supported in a certain kind of way, I think there's something for me turning to text. There was a point I turned to text a little bit more in my practice, and that was somehow about the production of ideas, somehow, and the production of sharing those things. And text is quite an economical way to work, I think.
No. Olivier and Jonas, do you want to say something about the economy?
I seem to go with Greeks, and I think that we don't have much choices, that the seven muses, they are very willful, and they just impose, come to you, and you have no choice, and they dictate what art you will choose, and even in case of drama, literature, poetry, they decide, and you have no choice, and you just do what they get into you when you are still young, you see, weak, when you cannot resist. They're very willful. And they stayed with you, and you cannot escape it, and you just keep doing it, and keep doing it. If you cannot write, then you lead, they force you to lead a poetic life. They say, life is, you know, his life is real, he's like a poet. You see, life can be poetic also, not only, you know, forms of literature. Yeah, that's my, more or less, how I look at it. No choice.
I would agree with that.
No choice.
Sorry. The muses, absolutely. And then also...
Get bad.
Yeah, get bad, yeah. In the idea of, yes, I mean, it was never any involvement in thinking about money when you write. I mean, it's not about it. It's totally getting somewhere else with it. And so, of course, yes, it's really independent of this kind of problem.
But one thing which is obviously also interesting is that when I spoke to the Campos, no, the concrete poet in Brazil, he was saying that for him and his generation's concrete poet, more the idea was also how could poetry be carried back into the exhibition, no, and how could it actually become, you know, even the city, you know? You're thinking about poems as neons in cities, you were thinking as poems in the exhibition. And this morning, very early, I walked to the fair and stood a long time in front of your work, Tracey, The Volcano Closed, and was reading again and again in a very non-linear way, and it was, had a lot to do with your poetry. So it's obviously this idea that poetry can also migrate, and I suppose it can migrate into objects, it can migrate into exhibitions, it can migrate into displays.
Well, I've always written, and I've been writing longer than I've actually been making art. And people often ask me a question: what do I think I'll be doing when I'm old? And I imagine myself sitting at a table writing, no studio, no stuff, just me and a pen, this book and a pen, and it's complete freedom. It takes me away from all the entrapment of everything. And often I compose things. When I wake up very early in the morning, usually 5 or 6 in the morning, and I like to lay there for an hour just thinking thoughts. Yeah. And that's one of my favorite things to do.
Yeah, actually, that's very important. The idea of writing only really demands a pen and paper and yourself, which is totally freeing from the world we're in today, where you always have to have something else. And that's quite something liberating.
Paul Valéry, discussing poetry, you thought that It's attitude. It's an attitude. I mean, there are forms of literature, you know, haiku, lyrical poem, sonnet, etc., etc. But also, it meant me the attitude, the state of being that pervades then whatever you do, in whatever art you are. Well, you are a carpenter, you could. How you see the world, and you know. But this is something else. I suspect that muses, like everybody else, may have children, and they are not that good yet. And sometimes that's where the bad poetry and bad art come. There are no kids muses, you know, children. You know, they have daughters and sons, and Olympus is very complex.
Brilliant way of seeing it.
Does anybody want to react to that? I've got many more questions, but we can answer
that. Jean Cocteau was saying that the reward for artists is not money or fame, or this is not why we do it, but it's because it's addictive.
Anybody else want to add something to that?
Well, maybe Paulo Coelho says that, for example, we're trying to write to avoid to be cornered, which means we're writing not to be, of course, praised or anything like that. It's about to create a space somewhere which is holding the magical, the most beautiful, and it's thus untouchable because it's nowhere to be seen immediately.
This morning I went to the Guardian website and read the obituary of Christopher Logue, who was a poet in England I knew very well and had made many interviews with, and he obviously made many bridges between visual arts and poetry because he wrote visual poems, he collaborated with artists such as David Hockney and did his famous posters. He also made postcards out of his poems and always understood his work as being very political. And I went back to the interview I made with him a couple of years ago where he talked about this whole idea of different forms of political poems, now in avant-garde, but then also at some moments maybe poems finding more popular forms of writing poems, you know, to have a sort of a political impact on that. And so kind of remembering Christopher Logue, also a little bit as an homage to Christopher Logue, I was kind of wondering if you maybe could talk a little bit about this aspect. He emphasized so much about sort of the political dimension of poetry, also protest poems.
Well, it's not a necessity, but it's certainly useful to be able to express whatever you like. Anyway, that's a freedom of poetry. It can't be cornered. So there's always space, and maybe somehow for some duty to talk about politics in that way, yes.
I mean, I guess kind of avoiding being cornered is a political act in and of itself, I guess. So attention or paying attention to text
or something. Yeah.
I mean, this is...
It depends how you define political. I think that a poem by Basho is can be political in the sense that he stands for a certain kind of way of life and thinking, and what is the real politics to me is something that affects the society, humanity, in some way, as you know, all the big politicians try, but those that affect positively, according to me, like to me, political contemporary, real politicians were Buckminster Fuller, John Cage, the Fluxus Movement, that affected, and B Generation, that affected the style of life, of thinking, and took a little bit humanity towards what I consider good, positive thing. So to write openly political, you know, that poem, you know, what's understood by political poem is one thing, but I think Basho is also political.
Tracey and Karl, can you maybe talk about
Well, for me, there's all different kinds of political poets, from feminist poets to all kinds of people.
Like Rumi was, for me, political.
Yeah, I think so as well. So I was going to different extreme examples, but for me, growing up, we were taught at school, Wilfred Owen was what we were taught at school from the age of about 12 to 14. And we understood the disasters of war and the inflict that war could have on someone's mind through reading this poetry. So a lot of people of my age grew up really questioning war, but not through a political aspect, but through the poems of Wilfred Owen. And that's quite a profound thing, because we were so young and so touched by his memories and his feelings of war. So that's, I'm very base when I think about it. We can go the other extreme, like you said, like Rumi or whatever, and you can stretch the idea of politics. But for me, it's just definitely a kind of baseline way of thinking at the effect that it has on me.
And Karl, can you maybe talk also about this idea of what Jonas says when he says about affecting society or affecting humanity?
Yeah, I mean, it's also language, no? I mean, the politics is not self-expression, but it's an expression of time, I guess, and the kinds of slogans and words, formulations that one can find in politics can also be used for other uses. I mean, this is more how I would see it, the other thing is also if we're involved in this sort of impossible activity of putting words together and taking years before finding the correct formulation, I mean, we also need to somehow position ourselves. I think it's important to interact with society in that sense, and this would be maybe some type of political expression, but I don't think poets should be doing politics or
why?
You see, we have Guernica and we have Goya, but it's not political, it's a record of brutality of, you know, humanity. So that's
but the effects that it can have can be political. Yes, that's what I was trying to say. You know, Wilfred Owen, when he wrote it, he wasn't trying to be political. He was trying to give this personal account of what he witnessed that was so horrific, which then has an effect on us. Mm. I'm just trying to give a really straightforward example. I mean, we can go into it in a really complex way, but we don't need to, because it's an obvious, I think we all agree, it's an obvious thing. Apart from Karl, who said poets shouldn't be political.
Shouldn't be practicing politics.
Shouldn't be practicing politics when there's so many.
But I was always rethinking that as I was saying. But I mean, because we have this kind of professional politicians at the moment, and they're not doing a very good job. I mean, so maybe we should just hand politics over to poets at this point. I mean, so we can really make a mess.
Yeah, but then there's famous politicians that were poets. So.
Yeah.
But when Neruda begins to praise Stalin, that's something else.
Maybe
poets should stay out of politics.
Yeah, that's what I thought. That's what I thought I said from the start.
I think it's Sildo Meirelles, so in a new title, I don't remember the title now, but it's something about the project hole to throw in politicians or something like that. That's a new Sildo Meirelles idea. But one last question before we open it to the floor is actually the sort of whole idea about sound also, because Christopher Logue, when I visited him, talked about war music, and it sort of ties in with what we just discussed, because writing this poem, War Music, a very sort of open and also epic poem, he starts the poem with, now hear this. These are the first three words of the poem, now hear this. And obviously the sort of whole connection between music and poetry is so important throughout history. And also Wallace Stevens made a comparison from poetry to music to the one of fictive music. And I was just wondering, as a last question, if you could maybe talk a little bit about that connection. And
well, in my view, for example, that's why I picked Duras, Marguerite Duras. She has such a specific rhythm and sound of her writing. that it creates that melody, that song, that you recognize immediately. And to me, that musicality is essential to one style or poem or person. So it is very musical, yeah, of course. Absolutely.
I mean, when you said, now hear this, I was wondering if it was N-O-W-H-E-R-E-T-H-I-S or H-E-A-R-T-H-I-S. And this is a nice transition. I think this is a beautiful thing. I think the different values of text, bureaucratic texts, incidental text, text moving past text at fast speeds, they all have a different kind of tenor, I guess. And I think it's good to recognize what that tenor might be or what they might sound like. It's, yeah.
I haven't got much to say about it, really. I've said it about we're talking about Karl and about, but it's true, the sound of text is important, because do you hear the voice of the person who wrote the text, or do you hear your own voice reading it? And it's like when you read poetry, some poetry is really visual, and some poetry is just purely about the words. So do you, or when you hear it, do you see the words, or do you see the description?
Mm. Yeah, or can you go between those different things? I mean, that's the best way, I guess, when you have a visual thing, you have a melody, and you have a content, and you have a perfect poem all of a sudden. But for me, it's very much connected with the memory and the act of remembering, and you have this kind of music and melodies that somehow stay in your head. And I also like to plant my own melodies inside the heads of the people who listen to me, and then they can remember me forever in the back of their memory.
But we were talking about this earlier, and some people just don't perceive the world in a poetic way. They see the world in a very analytical, straightforward way. What you see is what you get. And there's other people that are constantly delving and trying to make things as flowery and as poetic and as beautiful or as emotional as possible. And it's like looking at a field with very long grass with the wind blowing across it. Some people will just see the wind blowing across the field, and other people will see something completely different, and something which you can definitely hear.
Or hear the...
Yeah, definitely. And some people just won't hear it, and they won't... All they might just see is literally the grass moving. But other people will see something more poetic.
Now, before we open it to the floor, I do have one very last question, because actually yesterday I walked through Miami thinking about the panel and thinking, what am I going to ask and what could we discuss? And then all of a sudden, I came across this amazing vitrine at the Rosa de la Cruz collection of Felix Gonzalez Torres, which is, I mean, there are the works of Felix Gonzalez Torres, but then there is a vitrine of all the letters and postcards he had sent, actually. And in this vitrine, there are not only these amazing photographs and postcards, but there is also a book by Rainer Maria Rilke, which is his famous, you know, Advice to a Young Poet, which was one of Felix Gonzalez Torres' favorite books. And so I was kind of wondering, maybe as a last question, and maybe to start with Jonas, what would be your advice to a young poet, to a young artist?
Go for it. Do everything not to write. Resist as much as you can. And write only if they're about to lock you up. And then you write.
Olivier?
Well, I say the opposite somehow. I say go for it. Don't hesitate. Go for it. Write as much as your soul, heart, content. Write it out.
Tracey?
Write as many letters as possible to as many people that you love.
Gerry?
I'm the youngest person on this panel, so I don't know who to give advice to. But... Go, I say. Just keep trying that thing.
Carl?
Yeah, I'd say write by hand, and be careful with your heart.
Thank you all so much.
It's a bunch of fail.
Super, Carl.
And it is now the moment to open it for your questions. I see a question here, a question here. Can you have the mic, please?
It's coming. Just that way. Good.
My name's Michael. Question for Tracey. If I heard you right, you said in school you grew up on the poems of Wilfred Owens.
Yeah.
I can't imagine in America young adolescents growing up on the poems, even having heard of Wilfred Owens. 99% probably even of Americans never heard. What kind of school did you go to?
I went to a secondary modern school that was actually quite rough and quite difficult. There was about 60 people in a class. The majority of people come from very humble, poor backgrounds. We weren't expected to have anything more than a secondary education. We were expected to leave school at 16. But I actually left school, I said 13, 14, because I had to think about it. I actually left school at 13, and then by law, I went back when I was 15 to do 3 days a week. So I went to a really rough school. There were fights every day, people carried knives, people played frisbees with razor blades in. But we had some really good teachers. And that's education, that's what's important. And at the moment, I'm trying to get poetry put back onto the school curriculum that it's compulsory for children under the age of 11. And that's what I'm trying to do at the moment.
There was a question here in the middle.
My name is Barbara, and I am wondering if most of you, all of you, are visual artists who combine your poetry in some way with your visual art.
Yes.
Yes, I think we all do.
Yes.
Yes, we do.
Yes,
we do. Well, yes, Tracey, yes, obviously, yes. I mean, we're quite known for the neon, which the use of words made it obvious. But we all do, I think, in the visual art, integrate phrases or words for it, yeah, as they are.
I often say there's some people who proclaim to be artists and they paint pictures of horses every day and they've never made a piece of art in their life. All they've ever done is make a picture of a horse. And there's other people who are writers like James Joyce. And I say, if you just hold anything by Joyce in your hand, you're holding a fantastic piece of art. So some writers are just pure artists, even though they work with the written form, I think.
Yes, my name is Ariana Ospina, and I'm an artist, and I wanted to ask you, regarding what Karl was saying, in which part the artistic object and your poetry mix or get enhanced together? And also, could each one of you give an example of an artwork you like that does that? That's not yours, of course.
In what part?
Where the artistic object gets enhanced with your poetry. Do you think all artworks do that, or some artists don't? Or that's my question.
I don't understand.
I don't quite get it.
Always. I mean, I don't see this kind of separation between image or language. I mean, it always needs to be coming together, and one can think of Japanese calligraphy, for instance. I mean, as an example of images with words, and even the alphabet using the kinds of signs that they use in Japan is a kind of visual expression, and that's one example.
Gerry?
Ouch.
Yeah, it's so strange. I mean, I guess I was showing Karl yesterday in the hotel room. I had written, typed something into a computer and printed out somewhere strange. And of course, it all came up in these weird fonts that didn't make any sense. So, I mean, I guess those transitions can happen by accident. But as far as an artwork, you know, is this Larry Johnson thing in here? That's also very nice somehow. In the fair.
Tracey?
I have a Jenny Holzer bench, which has a very poetic paragraph on it, but it's so long I can't remember it all, but it's about being interrogated, like you die fast so they can't get you, or live long enough so they're so too embarrassed to interrogate you. And I have that in my garden, and me and my cat, we sit on it, and it gives me a lot of pleasure. And when I was in Istanbul Biennale in 1997, I think, yeah, and I had two neons made. I had to hang in the train station. I had one in Turkish, and then I had the same neon made in English. The Turkish neon makers made the Turkish one absolutely perfect, but the English one was illegible. You couldn't read it because they didn't understand what it was saying in English. So lost in translation was an understatement. But and then it's the same as what Karl said. I mean, sometimes Korean people really love, or Korean or Japanese, or really love my neons, and they don't respond to the English or to the words. They just respond to the drawing and to the flow of how it looks. So it's a strange thing. But yeah, Jenny Holzer. I've got a lot of artists whose work I like that's text work.
Olivier?
Well, one of my first attempts to mix literature and sculpture was simply to put a book on a sculpture. The sculpture was holding the book being the sex of the character in the sculpture. And you had to touch the sex to read the book. That was sort of an example, for example, I can come up with in that way. But I can't say it was extremely successful. There's a lot to do in that. There's still a lot to go, a long way to go.
And Jonas?
I will skip this one.
I just wanted to say maybe also, I wanted to mention Cy Twombly, because actually I think the whole work of Cy Twombly could be also the answer, everything he's ever done. And I must say this panel happens really thanks to Cy Twombly, because when I was a teenager, I went for the first time to Rome, and I met Cy Twombly, and he actually told me that he found it very, very strange that I knew so much about art and nothing about poetry. And he really gave me the mission, read poetry. I kind of followed his advice. So anyway, this about Cy Twombly. Are there more questions? Is there a question here?
Yeah, my name is Manny. This is a question for the panel in general. You know, the relaxation of the grammar rules and text messaging and all that, that people just say, you know, whatever initials. I'm wondering how, do you think that's a negative in terms of, like, you know, destroying the rules, or do you think that it's like more of a freedom and it lets you express better, just in general for the panel?
My mum's 83, and she only learnt to text message about 4 years ago, and she sends me these abbreviated messages that just go T, G, now, chill. So she said, oh yeah, I'm gonna now go chill, kind of thing. And this is my mum, and she's 83, and I'm thinking, who is teaching her how to text message, you know? So I'm open to anything personally, but one thing is, any of my friends know I do not like speaking on the telephone, or I actually shouted at someone yesterday. I said, you know I don't like speaking on the telephone, and they said, that's what a telephone's for. And I said, no, not anymore, it's for writing on, so.
Michela Bondardo. My question, I was wondering what means today to be careful with art? You were saying before, be careful. And I completely agree with you, but I was wondering what it means today.
Well, it means the same thing as it always did. I mean, we have...
What does it mean to be careful about art?
Beauty in our hearts, especially when we're young, and then somehow it gets lost on the way, or we imagine that, but maybe it's not, but that's why we need to be careful with it.
A question here.
My name is Dave,
And this question is for Tracey. And it's about sharing. And in regards to the advice, I'm just wondering about different ways of going about sharing art and kind of who sees the poem or the drawing when you release it and like how you release it. Because your advice was to write many letters to people you love. I'm just wondering about ways of releasing such intimate
Yeah, but the love letters only go to one person. They're not repeated. And going back to Karl, right? Yeah, he's so right. Be careful. You can often see my letters on eBay. So, you know, sometimes I send them, I've made a big mistake in my life, you know. So, but on the other hand, I don't want to be stopped from freely thinking. And when I write a letter and I put it in the post and I send it to someone, it gives me a feeling that I've just released something and it's going out into the world. Maybe the eBay thing's taking it too far into the world, but it's going somewhere. It's not all locked up inside me and driving me insane or making me feel ill. And there's a thing, I think, what Karl is maybe trying to say. I think poetry is really good for the brokenhearted. It really does help, and it really does work. So, and my work, my writing is everywhere within my work, but it's like the volcano blanket that's here. It might be more hidden, you know, but the love letter is a real genuine stream of consciousness of what I'm thinking at that time to one person. So, and I write books, so people can, you know, buy a book or and I think I have a website now which will be poems will be loaded up on as well. So, but the best thing is that, you know, we're here, this panel, and we just all read something out, and you're here listening, really here, and it's in the air, and it'll only hang around for a short while, and then bing, it'll be gone.
Yeah, well said. It's important to happen.
So we have two more questions. We can take two more questions, because I think we are running out of time, but there are many more questions, so.
Okay. I'm assuming that a lot of the panelists are bilingual. So my question is, have you ever experimented with writing in different languages, and how does that affect your writing when you're writing poetry, when you're expressing yourself?
I'll take that one. Well, it's very important. It actually opens a lot, because when you compare the feeling you have of that word in your original language and then you compare it to another language, it's not exactly comparing ever completely. So it opens doors. So it's really interesting actually to confront yourself with different languages. It really opens plenty of possibilities, and making mistakes and misunderstanding. For example, the mug, we worked that with Sarah quite well. Misunderstanding things that create a new thing, and that's quite exciting. So yes, learn languages, go for it.
Anybody else want to?
Yeah, this was the quote you were showing us this morning, Hans, from Czeslaw Miloš, who's talking about only being able to write in would that be Polish or Lithuanian? Where is he from exactly?
Polish,
yeah. And
because he
wouldn't access his own inner person in any other language, and I would say I have somehow, I mostly write in English, and my native language is Swedish, and I'm actually trying to avoid going into those deep memories, and I'm trying to find a different type of language which would be more a kind of a surface or media language somehow, and change this through rhythm or music or through reworking it into something different, and so it also depends on what type of writing or what type of poetry writing you're thinking.
That's because it's foreign that it gives you that freedom somehow.
But
Jonas, what about you?
I think that language is such a subtle instrument, and I do not believe that one can write poetry in any other language but the one in which you grew up, because then all the subtleties of the language, you have to grow up with it. Of course, some have tried to write in adopted new language. In prose, like Joseph Conrad has succeeded. Nabokov have succeeded, though it's, you know, English very bizarre, very artificial. But those are very rare exceptions. Some, okay, Celan, I think he grew up in maybe two languages. There are a few poets that grew up with two languages. That's something else. But I don't believe that one can write poetry in adopted, learned language, because you don't really, the subtleties somewhere disappear.
I'm not bilingual. I didn't go to the right kind of school to learn languages, and I haven't done it. All I've done is art, and I haven't given myself time, but I speak some Turkish. My dad was Turkish Cypriot, and I asked my dad, I said to him, what language do you dream in? And he said, if I'm dreaming about your mother, it's in English, and if I'm dreaming about my wife, it's in Turkish. Which I thought was really interesting. Sweet. I never asked him what language he wrote poetry in, but I'm sure it would be, you know, he would divide the answers again. So
we found the quote Karl was referring to, which is from Czeslaw Milos, and he said that I have been faithful to my native tongue, namely Polish, living for 40 years in America. I have never attempted to write poetry in English, and I knew other poets in America who continued to write in Russian, in Chinese, in Spanish. Which very much is what Jonas also said, no? Mm. But there are many more questions. There's a question here, there is a question here.
My name is Jonathan. I'd like to thank you very much for organizing this panel, Hans, and each and every one of the panelists has contributed so much. And I feel it's you've enlightened us about so much. And also, if some of the U.S. United States politicians would just contemplate art and poetry a little bit more, that would be well worth it to their constituents. Thank you.
We've got a question. Thank you. We have a question here.
I grew up in England too, Tracey, and I think we're contemporary, and I didn't read poetry actually in school in London. My daughter, however, is 14, and she's in a school that is completely centered around the written word, expository writing, through the analysis of their environment, their relationships with their peers, and with their families, and with the world around them. And it's an extraordinary gift to my life, and as well to hers. I wonder if you would come and read at her school. Actually, I'd have any one of you read at her school. And I too would like to thank you for the selection of every one of these people speaking to us today. I really appreciate the depth and the breadth of which you've communicated your love for the written word.
Thank you.
Good to hear.
Thank you very much. We've got a question here, and a question in the middle.
Hi, I just wanted to say that, like, one reason that we thank all of you.
My name is Glory, not always Hallelujah. And I just really want to say that if it wasn't for poetry and all of you, that for, like, you save our souls, because you're the ones that are able to, you know, write, have the written word, musicians, singers, artists, and not everyday people are actually always just have the freedom to do that in their world. So that I feel like is a major connection for all of us here with you. And I want to just say thank you. That's great.
Thank you.
It's a lot of thank yous.
Yes, hi. My name is Odalis. I would like to address this question to Hans, and is in regards to the title, which is the future of artistic practices. And I found that really challenging. But at the same time, you've been talking about a very old practice. So I would like you to please elaborate a little bit more about it.
Yeah, the title, I mean, as I said in the introduction, we were thinking, you know, with Basel, Miami, how we could develop after this museum panel, which, because this idea that a panel is not a one-off is very interesting, no? And we have all these events in the world, and they come, and then, you know, the next topic comes. But we think it's very interesting to do panels over many years, over 5 or 10 years. And we did it with the museum, no? Again and again, we other angles to the museum. And we tried to find a topic where we could do that again over many years. And this idea of looking at art practice in the 21st century, and it just seemed to be very urgent to look at these many different parallel realities. I mean, David Deutsch talks about, in his wonderful book, Fabric of Reality, he says that the 21st century has to do with these parallel realities. And I think we have today so many artists who have a parallel reality as architects, so many artists have a parallel reality as we could see today as poets, and to sort of explore that over the next couple of years, and we, you know, continue that now over the next at least, you know, year and so, and see how it evolves. It's a marathon and not a sprint.
Okay, my name is Sarah. I had a question for Tracey. I'm sitting here thinking about the history that lies behind the work that all of you are doing now, and it seems to me that one of the earliest artists we can think of who engaged poetry and visual art really in an intimately integrated way was William Blake. I'm wondering if, I arrived a little bit late, so forgive me if we've already discussed
William Blake. We haven't, but it's brilliant that you brought, I was going to bring William Blake up, but I was thinking someone's going to mention William Blake.
Can you talk to us about his legacy and his importance to you?
Well, William Blake is just like a fantastic sort of expressionist, just throwing everything out there visually. And he's a brilliant example. When you read his poems, you see everything, you feel everything. And you feel the emotional content, you feel the fire, you feel the brimstone, you see the waves crashing, you know, you see the light flashing. It's really, like, magical. Some people don't like William Blake for that. But, of course, I love William Blake for that. So, but I think, yeah, definitely a true artist that's a writer that should combine the whole visual thing with the sound thing that we're talking about. When you hear the sound of the poems, the writing, you can actually see the images and the pictures, which is a good thing. But fantastic. I'm glad William Blake. Love William Blake, yeah.
The invisible worm that flies in the night on a howling storm has found that bed of crimson joy and thy life destroyed. William Blake.
William Blake is a visual artist and a visionary poet, and I often bring him up as an example when I talk. He had one exhibition in his life in his brother's print shop, and it was totally panned by the critics. He never tried again, and yet he worked his whole life, and we have friends and people we surround us with who have a crisis if they don't have 10 one-person exhibitions per year or something, and no one understands my work and where am I going, and William Blake had one exhibition in his life.
But poetry was not always printed, like books were not always printed. They were handwritten until Gutenberg came in. So you can imagine transcribers of poetry and literature and in general, what those monks had. They had great times sometimes. I can imagine when Petrarca, before Gutenberg, was walking across the, was on Mont Ventoux in Provence. He writes that he was carrying with him and reading and stopping and contemplating Saint Augustine's Confessions. So you imagine that was not a printed volume. It was handwritten, beautiful volume, copied by some monk. And there he was, maybe a very beautiful, like a pre-Blake kind of little volume that he was carrying with him as he was contemplating existence on Mont Ventoux.
Someone else want to comment on Blake? Or then we have a question here.
Tracey, and I just wonder if any of you hear poetry in contemporary musical lyrics, and if so, what musician would you note for that?
Serge Gainsbourg. Sorry, that's one.
French. Serge Gainsbourg.
Yeah, Serge Gainsbourg.
That's true, though. Serge Gainsbourg, definitely. It's and one also of them. With the kind of music, everything, not just the words or the lyrics, but the whole makeup of the music. David Bowie.
Yeah, sure.
And David Bowie made lots of his work, but like Jean Genet, using cut up poetry and broken poetry. But I get mantras in my head where I just hear the same chorus again and again and again. And for the last month, all I've had is the Red Hot Chili Peppers. Again and again and again. Yeah, it's a really brilliant, which I don't know what it's called. I know the one, the most famous one. What's it called? About being alone, the bridge, or whatever it is. So, yeah. Johnny Cash.
I think I'm a little unfaithful. I think I go between different genre, and I think they've all got something to say.
Questions? There's a question here.
Hi, my name is Daniel. I'm an aspiring artist. I wouldn't give myself the title of artist just yet, but at the beginning of the discussion, we mentioned about the economy of art. I was just wondering, all of you are, just because you're here, you're all notable artists. I was wondering, finding the compromise, I guess, of the economy and making money off of your work and kind of demeaning your artistic integrity, I guess you'd say, in doing work that you don't necessarily. I was wondering what your opinion was on that, and I guess if that adds to you as an artist or takes away, or whatever it is that you guys think of that.
So, I've got to go in a minute because I've got a plane to catch, but I've got a lot to say on this. I don't make money, I make art. I've always made art. The money comes afterwards. That's a fluke. I'm lucky, you know. It's just an amazing thing. But when the recession started, like about 5 years ago, a certain gallery, I'm not going to say who, said, we've got 10 people waiting for blankets, Tracey. Make some blankets, because there's a recession hitting and nothing's going to sell. And I said to them, there was more chance of me setting myself alight than there was me making another blanket.
My name is Kevin Arrow, and thank you all for coming to Miami. This is a highlight of everyone who lives here. It's a highlight of our year. And I just want to go off topic perhaps for a second and ask Jonas if he could perhaps share a short anecdote about Harry Smith and his relationship to poetry and perhaps filmmaking, or poetry and living. Thank you.
Anecdotes about Harry Smith. I guess he was a poet. The simple anecdote is that he became part of Ontology Film Archives when we were building it, and there was no heat, no nothing, and he had no place to work. He had a place together with some other homeless people to sleep on the Bowery, but to work he used to come like 8:30 like everybody else and stays there. We gave him little room and he left at 5:30 with everybody else, and we had no heat, so he had his he was doing his painting with gloves that he cut the tips of the mittens, so that he could handle the, and with the same was with all of us. We typed with mittens the whole cold winter as we were trying to build, you know. And then when he used to get drunk, you had to be very careful walk with him in the streets, because he used to run and grab the fire and those fire. Red handles that we have in New York that calls the fire department, and we had to save him so many times from the police. And and etc., etc. But he was great. He was.
Now we have to unfortunately close. You wanted to say something, Karl?
Yeah, I just wanted to get back to Daniel, I think your name was, and the future of artistic practices, which is also somehow coming back to what we were saying in the beginning, that you can actually write poetry with nothing. I mean, you can. So this would be a possibility of always being very creative and working as an artist is actually to write, and as a piece of advice to a young poet or a piece of advice to a young aspiring artist, then in this case it would be to also to copy things. If you don't understand someone's writing, you should copy it by hand, and through that gesture of copying a text, you actually enter it, and you're also somehow making something yourself, because you're making your own copy, but you also get to communicate with the text, and it can take you places, and it can also take a while, so you have something to do then while you're doing it.
One last anecdote on Harry Smith, and he was staying for some time at Allen Ginsberg's place, and one day Allen noticed that there is a hole in his window. So he said, well, what is that hole in the glass of the window doing? Then he noticed that Harry gets up at midnight and he sticks out the mic and records the noises of the Lower East Side at midnight. Then he goes to sleep. Then at 2 o'clock he again gets up and records the sounds of the streets, of that street at 2 o'clock. And so the whole day after day, and then there are boxes and boxes of the sounds of the streets of New York, the poetry of the street noises of New York.
That could not be a more wonderful conclusion. So I'd like to thank, of course, our wonderful speakers, Jonas, Olivier, Tracey, Gerry, and Karl. I'd like to thank you all very, very much. And also for the wonderful organization, I'd like to thank Claudio Fock. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.